Thanks so much for joining us for CBN News Today. I'm Ephraim Graham.
And I'm Heather Sells. New England is recovering this morning from winter storm Juno after being buried under as much as 3 feet of snow. In some areas, the blizzard might not have lived up to all the forecasts and expectations, but it's still delivered a wallop across the Northeast. Dale Hurd has our story.
Millions of New Englanders are digging out from a thick blanket of snow today, and in some areas, it's still falling.
In many parts of Massachusetts, I think you could call it, in fact, an historic event.
Its winds howling at more than 70 miles per hour, the blizzard of 2015 slammed Boston and surrounding areas and was expected to shatter records.
We're still in the middle of a winter storm of historic proportions here in the city of Boston.
One snowbound resident shot this time-lapse video of her backyard deck disappearing in a mere 24 hours. Tens of thousands of homes and businesses in the Boston Cape Cod area lost power, including the entire island of Nantucket. Hurricane force winds brought a whiteout. The blizzard flooded the coastal town of Marshfield, destroying a 40-foot stretch of seawall.
This is horrible. We walked this wall yesterday and it's gone.
On eastern Long Island, an army of snowplows worked to clear highways. In Connecticut, snow buried cars. The big blizzard's unexpected eastward shift saved New York City and Philadelphia the worst of it. And New York City Mayor Bill de Blasio seemed to thank God for moving the storm. Listen.
This storm was real and it was as big as it was projected to be, but it moved eastward. And thank God for that.
Climate change experts had warned us we wouldn't see the snow in the future. And as recently as last year, the New York Times was asking if this is the end of snow. Nope. And in New Hampshire, the snow brought some fun.
Oh, it was worth it. Better than being cooped up at home shoveling.
More snow is forecast for later this week. Dale Hurd, CBN News.
Jordan says it is ready to trade a terrorist prisoner for a Jordanian pilot being held by ISIS. The terrorist Islamic State had threatened to kill both a pilot and a Japanese national unless Jordan agreed to release a female terrorist. She was sentenced to death for her involvement in a deadly terrorist attack in 2005. The mother of the Japanese hostage made an emotional appeal to leaders early Wednesday, asking them to, quote, please save Kenji's life. The deadline to meet ISIS's demand is Wednesday night, Japanese time.
Now we turn to Israel's northern border, where tensions are high after Hezbollah fired rockets from Lebanon at an IDF convoy inside Israel. The IDF shot back with artillery fire and air attacks. It also told residents of some border towns to remain inside closed roads, and it sent school children home. Some residents reported they heard digging underground, reminiscent of tunnels Hamas dug on Israel's southern border. The incident comes after Israel killed an Iranian general in a strike several days ago. Iran promised harsh retaliation.
A Libyan affiliate of the extremist Islamic State group says it is responsible for an attack on a luxury hotel in Tripoli this week. The attack killed 10 people, including one American. The Islamic State affiliate said it was revenge for the death of Abu Anas al-Libi. He died earlier this month in U.S. custody just days before his trial for the bombings of U.S. embassies in East Africa in 1998. The Islamic State claimed responsibility for the attack on social media, but experts say there's little evidence to back it up.
The governor of Louisiana says Islam has a problem. Bobby Jindal tells CBN's David Brody that it's time for Muslim leaders to reject the terrorists. And he says President Obama has also been too weak because he doesn't recognize Islamic terrorism for what it truly is.
For some reason, he doesn't like to use the word Islam and when we're talking about radical Islam. He doesn't like to use the word terrorist or terrorism. For it's not just rhetoric. When you look at their policies, it's almost like they want to treat this as a criminal action. And that's not what this is. Secondly, here is my challenge to Muslim leaders, because Islam has a problem. It's not enough to condemn acts of violence. They've got to condemn the individuals. They need to clearly say these are not martyrs. They're not going to enjoy a reward in the afterlife. We shouldn't be glorifying them. Instead, they should be saying very clearly, these fools are going straight to hell.
And you can hear more of our explosive interview with Jindal at David Brody's blog. It's called The Brody File, and you can find it at cbnnews.com.
European Union leaders are threatening more sanctions on Russia because of what they see as Moscow's growing support for fighters in eastern Ukraine. That move's come after Standard & Poor's downgraded Russia's credit rating to junk level Monday. It is the first time Russia's credit rating has been that low in more than a decade. Russia has been hurt not only by sanctions, but also by the sharp drop in oil prices in recent months. Russia makes much of its money from selling oil. Russia's currency, the ruble, also has plunged in the international trading markets.
Hundreds of Israelis, including Holocaust survivors, gathered in the northern Israeli city of Haifa on Tuesday to mark International Holocaust Remembrance Day. This year, it commemorated the 70th anniversary of the liberation of one of the most notorious concentration camps. CBN Middle East Bureau Chief Chris Mitchell has that story.
80,277. That's the number Nazis tattooed on 95-year-old Shoshana Kolmer's arm at Auschwitz decades ago.
I had typhus and was on my feet the whole time. I had a lung infection and a fever. I went to work because I didn't want to die by gas. I said, what will be, will be. If I die here, I die. But I didn't want to die by gas. And thank God, I stayed alive.
Kolmer gathered with about 100 Auschwitz survivors in Haifa to commemorate the liberation of the camp, where she spent more than a year and a half. She remembers the day the Red Army came to set them free.
A rabbi came, and he said, we are free, and we can go home. But who had a home? They killed all my family, my brother and sisters.
At Auschwitz itself, some 3,000 people commemorated the 70th anniversary of the liberation of the extermination camp. The Nazis murdered about 1 million Jews in Auschwitz-Birkenau, along with 100,000 other prisoners of war. As time goes on, there are fewer and fewer survivors. This may be the last big anniversary many of them will commemorate. They want to make sure that the horrors of the Holocaust will be remembered even after they're gone.
Many of them, when we talk to them, their greatest fear is that people really won't believe what happened to them and that they'll forget.
David Parsons, spokesman of the International Christian Embassy Jerusalem, spoke at the Haifa event.
Christians need to help preserve this legacy. We need to fight anti-Semitism. We need to help the survivors that are still around us. We need to help Jews who are facing anti-Semitism, like in France and Ukraine and other places, to come home to Israel.
Chris Mitchell, CBN News.
Speakers at the Holocaust events at Auschwitz in Poland warn anti-Semitism is skyrocketing in Europe. About 300 Holocaust survivors laid wreaths there to honor the victims. And the president of the World Jewish Congress said Holocaust remembrance is important because Jews are being demonized again across Europe.
I cannot ignore what is happening today. Jews are targeted in Europe once again because they're Jews.
In nearby Krakow, Jewish filmmaker Steven Spielberg offered a similar assessment. He's the director of the Oscar-winning Holocaust film Schindler's List. Spielberg warned about anti-Semites and fanatics targeting Jews today. He said, quote, the most effective way we can combat this intolerance and honor those who survived and those who perished is to call on each other to do what the survivors have already done. To remember and never forget. It means preserving places like Auschwitz.
A new report suggests personal freedom is on the decline. According to an annual report from the Freedom House, 60% of the world's population lives in countries that are not completely free. That is about 2.6 billion people. The study looked at 195 countries and 15 territories. In the end, it determined that 61 countries became less free in 2014 and only 31 improved. Terrorism had a devastating impact on that number, with Syria ranked among the world's worst countries.
Education officials are shutting down a Christian school in the United Kingdom. They say it's because the school is not doing a good job and the students are not tolerant of other religions. Officials condemn Durham Free School in a report that targets their Christian beliefs. It says, quote, leaders are failing to prepare students in life in modern Britain. Some students hold discriminatory views of other people who have different faiths, values, or beliefs. The report also blasts the Christian school for its hiring practices, saying governors place too much emphasis on religious credentials when they're recruiting key staff. School officials dispute the report, saying they will fight to stay open.
Coming up, groundbreaking new treatment for soldiers who suffer brain injuries and PTSD. Healing for their invisible wounds of war after this. The movie American Sniper has already made over $200 million, and it could become the highest-grossing war movie of all time.
It tells the true story of a sniper, Chris Kyle, and the invisible wounds of war. Wounds like post-traumatic stress disorder and traumatic brain injury, which can haunt veterans for years.
The Department of Veterans Affairs reports that in 2012, an estimated 22 veterans committed suicide every day. 22 per day, that is more than we lose in combat.
But as Caitlin Burke reports, there is a campaign to help veterans recover from these emotional scars.
Their time on the battlefield brings stories of heroism, sacrifice, and often devastation.
We were conducting a mission supporting Special Operations Forces just south of Fallujah, down by Amarillo, and the aircraft was hit with a surface-to-air missile. So I got the aircraft safe on the ground, and then we rolled end over end three times and caught on fire.
We were out on a mission, and we were going after a low-level bad guy. We had just missed him. We started to take fire, and what was a well-coordinated ambush. We had to fight our way out of there. It was an intense trip. We didn't end up finishing with everybody that we started with.
And then those warriors come home, ready to transition back into life with their friends and family. But all too often, those traumatic moments from war come home with them.
You're very agitated. Can't sleep. The demons come at night.
So you are in that heightened state of awareness. You're perceiving most things as a threat. You're going to a restaurant and you can't see anywhere but with the door to your front. You're scanning every room that you're in for possible ways it could go south, and then what your plan of action would be.
Both Coker and Marr felt the symptoms of PTSD and traumatic brain injuries. But their warrior nature caused them to push through, continuing to function on autopilot.
Prepare for mission, rehearsal, do the mission, come back, refit all your equipment.
In that community, however, negative stigma can surround this type of invisible wound. That often leads vets to ignore a brain injury or PTSD, which only makes symptoms worse. What begins as a sensitivity to light or sound can spread to the brain's emotional areas, then to the sleep center and more, until it becomes completely debilitating.
You get tired after a while. Just like, you don't give up, but you're like, doggone, what can I do now?
The only thing I could do I just got to drink. And if I drink, I can probably quell the storm a little bit or be able to present myself at home without being an emotional wreck.
Both Marr and Coker tried to find medical help, leaving with a bag full of new medications, but no real solution. Then their paths took them to the Carrick Brain Center.
Here at Carrick, they use revolutionary new technology to help figure out the root of the problem instead of just treating the symptoms.
When they're here all day. So they're doing detailed diagnostic testing, looking at eye movements and looking at balance and looking at, just how their memory is working. We take all of that information and then we sit down with them and we try to diagram out exactly what's going on.
One breakthrough that can only be found at Carrick is the vertical axis rotational device, or OVARD.
This allows us to work on a larger area of brain. So if you have someone that has an injury in the right frontal area of their brain, we can spin them leftward and backward, and by doing that, we can then activate that area of the brain. The more brain that is being activated, the greater the chances are of recovery.
Marcus Luttrell, the former Navy SEAL depicted in the movie Lone Survivor, is one of Carrick's highest profile success stories. Unfortunately, many vets struggling with a brain injury or PTSD never make it to a place like Carrick. Either they get discouraged by all the treatments that haven't worked, or they don't seek treatment at all, afraid it could cost them the job they love. For Marr, the risk of taking his illness back to battle was too great to ignore.
My thought was to get back onto the team, to get where I wasn't a liability. Turns out it wasn't that way, but you know, I can't second guess that call for a second, because you know, if I were to have something paralyzing happen to me in a bad situation, you know, in this line of work, that means that guys don't come home and they don't see their kids.
The Carrick Brain Center hopes to raise awareness and money for treatment through the Invisible Vet campaign.
So oftentimes you encounter people in the street, at a restaurant, at the bank, people that have been in uniform that have either had a traumatic brain injury or they've been exposed to traumatic experiences that has led them down the road of post-traumatic stress, or unfortunately they have had both. Those are things that you can't see them. And so it's not like a broken arm, or it's not like an infected wound where you might need antibiotics or a cast or a surgical procedure.
It's a movement to not only open eyes, but erase the stigma around this kind of invisible wound, in the hopes that future generations of soldiers will feel comfortable coming forward for help.
Thank you for your service.
My pleasure. Wish I could have done more.
Caitlin Burke, CBN News, Dallas, Texas.
A celebration 50 years in the making. See why the Bible has brought so much joy to the people of this small Asian village. The story's next.
Officials in a western Michigan county say they will reinstall a park sign that quotes the Bible. The sign carries an excerpt from Psalm 19 declaring the glory of the Lord. It was taken down last year after complaints that public property was being used to promote religion. After a 9-2 vote, county commissioners say the sign will return. The sign had been in the park since the 1960s.
So what happens when a remote tribal village receives God's word in their own language for the very first time? Well, if it is Papua Indonesia, the answer is a big party.
CBN News joins the party with the Irish Bible translator and the missionary pilots who helped make it all possible. Stan Jeter brings us this remarkable story.
The singing and dancing began as the tribe's people gathered near the small mountain airstrip in Papua, Indonesia.
We're here to celebrate the finishing of the complete Bible in the Hoopla language. So this is it. This is exciting stuff for us. We've been partnering with the missionaries that have been working to translate this thing for years and years and years. And so it's just great to be able to come and join them in the celebration.
For the past 40 years, Brown and other Mission Aviation pilots have flown the translating team in and out of the Soba airstrip. One frequent passenger was Sue Trenier, an Irish missionary. She helped Christian tribesmen translate the Old Testament.
We're sitting here on the top of the Soba airstrip, where the first plane landed here in 1968. Most of the Hoopla tribe of 3,000 people are busy digging pits to cook these pigs. They'll be having services, they'll be praising God, they'll be singing. There's all different groups from different churches. So all we're seeing here is like a Hoopla tribal party.
It took over 200 roasted pigs to feed the crowd. The spears the men carry are real, but after the gospel arrived 50 years ago, they stopped using them in tribal warfare. The New Testament was translated into their language, and the newly founded church began to grow. During this event, 26 converts were baptized. But the highlight of the celebration was the delivery of the completed Hoopla Bible.
This people group has had the translation in the New Testament for a while. And what really makes this dedication today unique is that it completes the story. It's the Old Testament. I get excited thinking about what it's going to be like for them to see God's story of salvation that begins in Genesis.
The first Bibles were given to a young man representing the youth, to a woman to stand for all women,
and to an older man, recognizing those who had waited many years for the entire Bible in their language.
Kenuel is a son of one of the translators.
Masihat, tadi pagi.
Our leader this morning that got the box of Bibles that had come to where we were sleeping. We had a special time of devotions together opening the Bibles. I'm feeling like I'll be able to learn more deeply about God's word. When I sit with my own people, I'll be able to read. We'll be able to read it together.
The Hoopla Bible translation was supported by the Indonesian Bible Society. According to Wycliffe Bible translators, over 1,800 languages are still waiting for the start of a Bible translation project. Stan Jeter, CBN News.
It is tragic that there's 1,800 languages that haven't been translated.
I tell you, but so nice to see the gospel come and make a difference in places like that. They say the gospel arrives, the spear's no longer used in warfare.
And it's time to party.
Indeed, indeed.
We'll be right back.
Stay with us.
And finally today, a major asteroid flew by the Earth on Monday.
And as you can see in this photo released by NASA, it even had its own small moon. The asteroid went by Earth at a distance of about 750,000 miles. That's about three times the distance of the orbit of the moon. The asteroid was about a third of a mile wide, and it was the biggest that will pass by Earth for at least another decade until the year 2027. Although this asteroid posed no threat to Earth, astronomers are still looking for unknown space rocks that could eventually hit our planet and do some extreme damage. Mm.
Really incredible stuff. Mm-hmm. Incredible how God created the whole world.
Amazing. Amazing.
Well, that is it for now on CBN News Today. And you can find more of our exclusive coverage of the issues that you care most about at cbnnews.com.
We want to know what you think about the stories you've seen here today. You can do that on Facebook or at CBN News on Twitter. Hope you'll join us again right here next time. Make it a wonderful Wednesday, everybody.